Okay. So we're going to get started out first real quick with a video. You may have seen that apart from stuff that I do on the cloud native content creation side, I also create a lot of videos related to boxing. I'll explain a little bit more. You may have seen this in LinkedIn or Twitter, but it's important for context because there's a lot of stuff that's going to be mentioned in here that we'll also be covering in the slides I'm going to show you. All right. So let me make sure my audio is good. Should be okay. Okay, was that okay? Maybe good, maybe not, we'll see. So, that being said, I need two brave volunteers who are not afraid to get hit in the face. Who's gonna join me on stage? We got one person, good? All right, but no, for real, no one's gonna get hurt. I know it's not the most traditional way to start a presentation that's gonna be about cloud native technologies, but believe me, there is a reason for all this, there is a method to the madness. So why did I choose this topic, all right? Like I said, I've been passionate about this sport for a long time, but I think it's important that you know other aspects of my life too, so it's just a little bit clearer. As Alexandra mentioned, my name is Bart Farrel. I'm originally from the Bay Area in California. Has anyone ever been to the Bay Area? San Francisco, maybe? Has anyone ever been to Vallejo, California? Yes, Alexandra has, congratulations. It's a little bit unknown in the Bay Area, but it's a very, very authentic place, wonderful people. So if you wanna find me on Twitter, really easy to find, birthmark Bart. You'll also see me, is anyone using Kubernetes? Kubernetes, all right, we got some, that's good. All right, this made my talk a lot easier. So I run a podcast called CubeFM, where we interview engineers, it's content from engineers for engineers, nothing sales related, talking about the technical challenges that engineers are facing, the choices that they're making, the open source tools that they're using to overcome those challenges in Kubernetes environments, all right? So that's one of my principal activities in terms of creating content in the cloud native ecosystem. But I've also been a CNCF ambassador for the last 3 years, and we'll be just got accepted to do another 2 years there. I live in Bilbao, in the north of Spain. Like I said, originally from Northern California, but I've been living in Bilbao for the last 12 years. And I also led the Data on Kubernetes community from 2020 to 2023, in which did various co-located events in KubeCon and about 250 live streams in that period of time, meaning learning a lot from very, very smart people about how they're running stateful workloads such as database, streaming, analytics workloads, AI and ML workloads on Kubernetes. Also, the DDF podcast, it's the Data Defenders Forum. A colleague of mine and I, we host sessions talking about things related to GDPR compliance, data privacy and protection. Yes, I know it sounds boring, but it's our job to make it exciting. So if that's something you're interested in as well. I'm also participating currently in a stealth startup that will be launched at the end of this month in Madrid. Very excited about that. I play different instruments. Also discovered drawing last year, something I really enjoy a lot. Team Sariri is the gym where I train. I was gonna wear the sweatshirt, but it's really too hot because the weather's great here. But a gym I'm absolutely in love with. I am not a graphic designer, as you'll see in my slides. They're very simple, but I want them to be easy to understand. And last but not least, I have ADHD. Does anybody else have ADHD? Yay, we've got some other people with ADHD, cool. We can talk about 50 different tangents whenever you want. But like I said, this talk that we're gonna be looking at today is about boxing and cloud native. So putting these two things together, that's gonna be my job, all right, to make the analogy correct. A lot of this is going to be about understanding a certain mindset. Well, there are key technical concepts that are very important in each one of these worlds, all right? There's a lot of other things that we have to keep in mind, and a lot of it starts with having the correct mindset. So, my backstory. This is me when I was 10 years old. My parents made a huge mistake, and for Christmas, got my brother and I a set of boxing gloves. That set of boxing gloves had a very short life, about a month, until we beat the shit out of each other so much that my parents said, okay, we're taking these gloves away. But what they did do then is that they put me in karate classes. So at the age, from the age of 10 till around I was 14, I did karate. Then after that, I got into wrestling. From there, I got into kickboxing. This photo was taken 20 years ago when I had a different body than the one I have now. But like I said, that's been my sort of backstory of martial arts. It's something that's always been present in my life. And since I moved to Spain, I found a gym there. But like something that you'll see as well too when we're talking about cloud native is that I tried different martial arts. In the end, I've settled on boxing because my legs aren't what they used to be when I was 18 years old when that photo was taken. But like I said, it's a journey, it's a process. And really thinking about these things long-term and the ways in which we learn throughout those processes from the people that we're around and the people who can help us grow, right? So like I said, that's my backstory there. Then, something that you'll see as well, right? You saw in the beginning with the video, but this is something that very much forms part of my life. When I'm not doing things in the cloud native world, I spend a significant amount of time, you'll see a big difference from my LinkedIn, Twitter content that's going out there, as opposed to the stuff that's in my Instagram, because my Instagram is mostly being sort of chief marketing officer for our gym, recording videos of the different fighters, the different training sessions, promoting the different activities that we're doing. So like I said, both these activities form a very important part of my life. Sometimes my wife complains that I spend too much time on the gym stuff because I do that all pro bono, but I get a lot out of it in terms of creativity, getting to know people better, and exploring other things that help me really, really well in my professional life. But like I said, if you see this stuff on LinkedIn and Twitter, it's much more focused on the cloud native side of things, of sharing knowledge, giving people spotlight, sharing new information about the different technical trends and challenges that are coming out there. Cool. Same thing with cloud native. So as Alexander mentioned in the beginning, the wrap thing, how did this all start? So when I started with the data on Kubernetes community, running stateful workloads on Kubernetes was not really that popular in 2020. There were two different schools of thought. There was the Kelsey Hightower school of thought that said, do not run stateful workloads on Kubernetes. It's a very bad idea. And then there was a growing school of thought that was saying, not only can you do it, but in certain situations, you should do it. So when we started in 2020, we had 120 people in our Slack channel, and we knew that we needed to grow. I didn't know a lot about, so another thing I'll explain as well too. I have never written a line of code in my life, all right? Never, not one. I've tried doing online Python courses and I failed miserably. I've tried doing other things and it just hasn't worked out, but that's okay, all right? I embrace those defects, those downsides that I have, and I know that there are other things that I can do. And so to quote James Brown, I don't know karate, but I do know crazy, all right? So I've stuck with that very much so in my professional career. And what I did know when I got started with the data on Kubernetes community is we needed to make it clear that we were doing something different and that we were inviting people to participate. So what I started doing is that every time we did a live stream, I would write rap lyrics. This is the days before ChatGPT, right? No, it was all original. And so it was something we would share on social media. So people would see, well, this guy does look like he's crazy, but maybe there's something to this community that I should check out. And it worked. In a few years, we grew to over 4,000 members. Like I said, put out a lot of content, got a lot more credibility, and more so than that, got people thinking about this idea that not only was it possible to run stateful workloads on Kubernetes, but it was actually a good idea for security purposes, for cost saving, for lots of other factors that came in there. And I also continued to incorporate the boxing element. When we would be promoting our events, I would sometimes weave those stories in together. So like I said, my cloud native journey and my journey with boxing have been very much linked, boxing and also more so creativity, for quite some time, all right? Good. Now, thank you, Bernie Sanders. All this stuff is fascinating, but what the fuck is this talk actually about? Very fair question if that's where you're at this point right now. So what we want to get at, the official definition of cloud native, because it's a term that we hear a lot, okay? Does somebody not know what the CNCF is, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation? It's totally fine if you don't. That's okay, he doesn't, thank you, sir. And did you sing yesterday in karaoke? And you did a very good job. Give this man a round of applause. Seriously. You sing Radiohead? Do you sing Radiohead? Yeah, that was really good. Yeah, anyway, go to karaoke. Karaoke's fun. This guy did a good job. So like I said, some people haven't heard of the CNCF. A lot of people that are in the CNCF as well as ambassadors feel like we can walk down the street and say, hey, when was the last time you were spinning up a Kubernetes cluster? And that everyone's going to say, oh, of course, 5 minutes ago. Well, it's simply not true. What I mean by that is that some people don't know what it is or maybe have a certain idea. I'll try to explain a little bit about my vision, but it really depends on who you talk to, right? The Cloud Native Computing Foundation was started in 2015 and basically is the home base for a lot of different open source projects. Last time I checked, I think there are about 180. That doesn't mean you need to know all of them or any of them. You just need to know that it exists, all right? But the official definition of what cloud native means, because you'll hear a lot of different things about resilience, about persistence, if we're talking about the data side of things, about reliability, about scalability, about vendor lock-in. But just to get started all on the same page, on the right foot, take a look at this definition, all right? So cloud native practices empower organizations. All right, we have this pretty long definition. I'll let you read it, all right? Related computing environments, public, private, hybrid cloud, to meet their organizational needs at scale in a programmatic and repeatable manner. It is characterized by loosely coupled systems that interoperate in a manner that is secure, resilient, manageable, sustainable, and observable. That's a lot of words, all right? So just say cloud native, right? Or maybe you've seen the Dilbert cartoon that if you're in a meeting, you just drop the word Kubernetes, you're gonna sound really sophisticated. But how do we actually unpack that? We're gonna unpack it based on my experience, because each person's experience of cloud native is going to be slightly different, all right? And a lot of this depends on an approach. The first contact, maybe it doesn't make a ton of sense. We need to see real world tangible examples that relate to the worlds and backgrounds that we come from. How many of you come from a data background? All right, we've got some, a developer background, right? Then more DevOps operations, SRE types, cool. So that's nice, all right? We have a diversity of opinions here, all right, and backgrounds. The point is here is that everybody has a place in the cloud native ecosystem regardless of their background. It all depends on your objectives and your interests. And we'll look at that more closely later on, all right? Looking at the landscape, a lot of people start here and say, holy shit, where do I begin? And that's why a lot about the cloud native challenge isn't necessarily just a technical problem of understanding the massive amount of information and projects that are going on. All right, after Linux, you know, Kubernetes is the second biggest open source project in history. After that, in the cloud native space, OpenTelemetry is one of the next biggest ones. But if you get into the Kubernetes Slack, they're like 100,000 people. So it might feel really overwhelming. But don't be overwhelmed when you start looking at this landscape. If you actually go to the CNCF website now, they've updated it and made it a lot easier to search by category, the types of different projects. If you're not familiar with the kinds of different projects, there are three types. There are sandbox projects, incubated projects, and graduated projects. The characteristics that make one project go from one phase to another are based on contributions, adoption, things of that nature. If you want to find more information about this, it's all on the CNCF website. Like I said, don't let your journey in cloud native be stopped or that you feel like you're getting hit in the face because of seeing this landscape. Because for a lot of people, it's very overwhelming. The technical side should be accompanied by the people side, just in the same way as how anyone can learn sports, in this case, martial arts or boxing. But like I said, we'll see the parallels, okay? A lot of times for people, learning cloud native sounds super exciting. Then day two, like I said, getting really burned out, feeling overwhelmed. And it's normal, because if you're doing it on your own, without any sense of support with coworkers or being in some kind of a class, that's absolutely normal that it would feel that way. The same thing that happens with boxing. If you've ever seen boxing on TV of professionals that are doing it, they make it look really easy. To do the things that they do really easily takes a lot of hard work, a lot of time, countless hours of practice and practice. Anybody here play a musical instrument? Guitar, bass, drum, something like that? It's the same thing. For Jimi Hendrix to be able to, because he's my favorite guitarist, for Jimi Hendrix to be able to do what he was able to do, there was thousands, not hundreds, thousands of hours of practice, sometimes practicing 10, 12 hours a day. So getting angry at yourself for not understanding all this stuff in 5 minutes is kind of ridiculous, right? So don't do that. And also, once again, as a person who's never written a line of code in their life, right, and is still continuing to work in this world, it's a silly thing to say, but if I can do it, anybody can. So let's keep going. In terms of objectives, you need to think about where you're at in your life, right? In terms of your career development, the technologies that you found interesting, the projects that you've worked on, the people that you've enjoyed working with, the people that you don't enjoy working with. I have that list very clear. But like I said, that's really, really important. In this case, taking the example of two completely different boxers, right? We have Floyd Mayweather, whose nickname literally is money, and he makes it abundantly clear that that's his objective. We can agree with it, we can disagree with it. I personally don't love the guy. He is a very talented boxer, but that's very much been his objective since the beginning. Is it raining in Malaga? Oh my God. On this side behind me, we have Siafer Lawless, who's an Irish boxing champion who's in high school, and immediately after winning the world championship, went directly back to school and got a standing ovation from all of her classmates because of the humility that she shows that we don't find in the case of Floyd Mayweather. So like I said, just in the same way as engineers, you get to decide, how public do I want to be? What projects do I find interesting? What kind of content do I like to consume? That's all up to you in terms of how you decide what your journey is going to look like. In the same way that I said earlier, I've trained in lots of gyms. No two of them were the same. Some common things, but at the end of the day, for me, it was really about the people. And you'll see the same thing in the cloud native ecosystem. Two basic objectives in boxing, all right? To hit the other person and to not get hit, all right? We have a fantastic example of Sylvester Stallone, first fighting Mr. T, and I think in the second one, fighting Apollo Creed, all right? Boxing, it makes it really simple. You can win by knockout, you can win by technical knockout, or you can win by points, right? Those things are very, very clear. Defining what winning looks like in cloud native is something that's up to you, but we'll look at that a little bit further down the line, okay? So in both these cases, in both these scenarios, you have to accept that you're going to get hit, all right? In boxing, what most people will do, you can watch tons of videos. The vast majority of human beings, if something is coming straight at their face, what do you think they're gonna do? Stand there and take it? No. The vast majority of people will do this, all right? It's a very natural human instinct to try to shield yourself and protect yourself, but guess what happens when you do that? You can't see the other person. If you do that in boxing and the other person knows what they're doing, you're gonna get hit even worse. So training yourself to stand while something is coming at you and not react in that way, a lot of what we're talking here is about training your emotions, because your body sends an emotional response, and simultaneously, it's kind of like the Matrix, but you're slowing down time and not letting that emotion overtake you, all right? In a similar way with cloud native, like I said, you look at this landscape, you see these technologies where it takes time. How many Kubernetes experts are there in the world? First of all, what's the definition of an expert? But we start throwing that around. We were talking about that two nights ago with some folks here, that you got Kelsey Hightower, Tim Hawken, Joe Beta, I could probably name a few others, but truly experts, basically the people that built it. And Kubernetes is going to turn 10 years old in June, right? So being really hard on yourselves about not learning all this cloud native stuff really, really quickly, it's kind of silly. Like I said, it takes time. So in the same way with cloud native as getting hit in boxing, developing those skills, developing those responses is going to be based on the amount of work, the amount of contact that you have, the amount of immersion, and the amount of training, if we want to think about it in that sense, right? Good. So basic things about boxing to protect yourself. You'll see fancy things in video games and also some professional boxers who intentionally fight with their hands down. Why do they do this? It's inviting their opponent to punch and then they can counterattack. It's also a way to conserve energy because if keeping your hands up also uses energy and it's tiring. In professional boxing, fights can go for 12 rounds. 12 3-minute rounds of boxing is really tiring. Another thing, keeping your chin down. Why? If I have my chin up, I make my head more of a target. If it's down, also if I get hit, my neck is supporting my head better. Your elbows in. Once again, we see lots of movies. If you watch Rocky, Rocky never puts his elbows in. Maybe by the fourth or fifth movie, he finally learns, all right? But in general, you want to keep your elbows in. Why? Because if you don't, you can get hit here, and that hurts a lot, all right? Knocks the air out of you. It's very uncomfortable. Keep your knees bent. Why? Because if you're standing up straight, you're much easier to fall over. If your knees are bent down, you're much more solid, and you're not going to move as much, and you can move your feet more quickly. A moving target. It's always harder to hit a moving target. Your head. If your head is static, you're telling your opponent, I'm always going to be here. This is why you'll see a lot of head movement. There are different ways of doing it, different schools of thought. Your waist, same thing here. You can bend down. Not too much, because if you do that, you're going to be inviting an uppercut. Your shoulders. You'll see it different. In kickboxing, it's more straight up because you have to be thinking about kicks. In boxing, it's more shielded most of the time, not all the time, because like I said, there are many styles. But this is another way of protecting yourself. And then your feet, all right? The position of your feet is crucial. Are you on your heel? If you're on your heels, you're gonna go back really quickly. Are you on the balls of your feet? It's also why boxers will wear special shoes that give them more agility and mobility. And also, don't open your mouth. Sounds silly, but just this little extra, if you get hit, it's gonna be a lot worse. Your mouthpiece won't protect you as much, okay? So it's, once again, we're seeing, this is a lot to take in. Not that much different from cloud native. It's not as simple as just plug and play or out of the box or download, no matter what marketing teams try to tell you. So like I said, you have to think of this as a holistic approach in both areas. And then, what about the stuff that you're gonna be doing to actually hit the other person? You have lots of things you have to keep in mind. Your jab, the most basic punch that you're going to do, sometimes is used just to establish distance between you and the other person. How far away are they? Am I inviting them in or making sure that they're not going to come in? Straight punches, right? So this is gonna be more your right hand. Then hooks and uppercuts. Hooks like this, uppercut like that. And then power shots. You get to decide, where am I most powerful? Everyone has a different build. I have relatively long arms. I don't have a big core. I don't have really big legs. So in general, I'm supposed to be thinking about distance. Someone who has shorter arms, like Mike Tyson, classic example, very famous boxer, short arms, but able to get in close and do a lot of damage. And counterattacks. Remembering, you're going to get hit. How are you going to respond? Everybody knows there's a fire in production. It's going to happen. There are going to be incidents. There are going to be alerts. There are going to be things that you have to respond to. How are you going to respond? Because you can't just sit there and keep getting hit, right? Like I said, this is all about developing a mentality. Now, things that you can do to train. Why do you see so many boxers, you know, jumping rope? Because it's all about your feet. Cardio, you'll see people running. Strength training, working with weights, heavy bag, speed bag, pad work. That's stuff you see where someone's holding like mitts, right? Where they do that for agility and also precision. Sparring, getting in the ring with somebody else and doing a sort of simulation of a fight. Most time with sparring, people say, okay, we're gonna go at 50%. Then you get hit in the face and 50% turns into 100 really quickly. But it's about emotional control. And you're sparring with people who are also your friends. So like I said, these things change. Common suffering unites people more than almost anything else, at least in my life. Teams that you've worked with where you've had huge problems, you may either grow to love each other a lot or perhaps it can cause friction. Like I said, these are the things that will create collective glue that really bring people together. Your diet matters, all right? Depending on what you are what you eat. So depending on that, it's also gonna influence it. Hydration, sleep, I know these things sound basic, but I feel like the older you get, the more you realize just how important they are. So you will need trainers. Right? You're gonna need trainers and you will need training partners in both these worlds. My trainer, his name's Hamid. He's from Morocco. He was a European and national champion in Holland in kickboxing, lived there for 10 years and then moved back to Spain and opened the gym where I train. Like I said, there are a lot of other people there. And you're gonna see why this is relevant, because just in the box, same thing in the boxing world, we'll also see this in cloud native, okay? So if our objective is, did anybody ever play Punch Out on regular Nintendo? Maybe, yes, good. Or it's got some Nintendo fans in the house. So if we're thinking about our objective is, I wanna become a cloud native champion. Look, we can make that a little bit more specific. I wanna become cloud native comfortable, all right? I wanna become a cloud native boxer, so to speak. I wanna start training in this world and really upskill so that I feel more comfortable in the tasks that I need to do in my job. But also, once again, having a clear objective. If you don't have a clear objective, it's gonna feel like you're not really making the progress that you want to make, that you're not getting as far as you want to, and they're not ultimately getting to the level that you want to be at as an engineer. Some people want to be a CTO. Other people, does anybody want to be a CTO? We got a couple of hands. I wouldn't want to do it. It sounds terrible. I'm a freelancer. I have to manage myself, and I'm my own boss, and I hate my boss, and I hate my employee too. But other people are really good at managing other people, so that's great. Like I said, knowing your objective, that's gonna guide you a lot more on what's important to learn, how to put these things in a sort of logical order. Good. Really easy thing now that didn't exist in the past, to figure out which cloud native projects are gonna work well for you. Nowadays, like I said, the cloud native landscape, the CNCF landscape, is much more interactive. So you can search by what kind of project it is, what kind of technology they focus on. Is it sandbox, is it incubated, is it graduated? Whoops, sorry, causing feedback. Sorry, sound people. But if you go to Clotributor, this makes it much more direct and much more specific. So you can put in here, for the data folks, has anybody ever worked with Kafka, for example? Yeah, good, a lot of hands. Yes, good, that's gonna tie in well with another example I have later. So if you wanna search for opportunities to contribute here, you just put the technologies that you've worked with or more general areas, we can say like observability or security, and that way it'll filter it for you, okay? And then you can cross-check this with the landscape. In terms of contributing, it's not a competition, it's not a race. Good things to do, go check out the documentation. Go see what good first issues there are. Based on the skill set that you have, where do you think you can help out the most, right? But like I said, don't rush into contribution. There's a very high rate of burnout in open source, and so just be mindful of that, about being realistic about how much time you can spend on these things, because sometimes it can snowball, and then something that should be fun and rewarding becomes a bit of a burden, and it loses the charm that it should have, right? Because it's not supposed to be about that. Good. So, perfect example, why I mentioned Kafka, Streamzy, wonderful project, all right, absolutely wonderful project. So event streaming with Kafka, providing Kubernetes native Kafka deployments, and provides a way to run Kafka cluster on Kubernetes in various deployment configurations, all right? I think it's been around since around 2019, so it's quite mature at this point. And as with every single project in the CNCF, it's not just about the technical side itself. There's always a community that's behind each one of these projects, which is why, as I said here, you need to find your gym. You need to find the place that's gonna work for you. Based on your objectives, your skills, interests, and talents, is it this place or is it gonna be that place, okay? In the case of Strimzy, the maintainer, one of the maintainers, is a wonderful person named Jakub Schulz who lives in Prague. Really, really nice guy. I've done multiple live streams with him, interacted with him. Every single CNCF project that you're gonna find will have some kind of content on YouTube. Just go to the CNCF YouTube channel. Someone will have spoken about it and probably more than once. But like I said, you've got different opportunities. You have Slack, you have local meetups anywhere in the world where you live. We do them in Bilbao. If you're ever in Bilbao, please contact me. You're more than welcome to attend, to speak. We do talks in English, we do them in Spanish, whatever works best for you. Like I said, documentation, or also being the maintainer. Jump into Slack, right? But generally speaking, it's a good idea to check out where the project's at, take a look at the documentation, and that way when you arrive, it'll be more rewarding, more informed, and more productive for you as well as the people involved in the project. Good. Other opportunities. For people that are more on Vitesse, since we have this as the SQL hall, I thought it was fitting to mention Vitesse. For people that are more on the database side, this is a very good example. It's a graduated project. So like I said, if that's something that you're more interested in, that could be good. Canister, this is a sandbox project. I know the maintainer, Michael Cade, he's a wonderful person. If you're more into backup and restore, this would be a good option. If you're into storage, you have Rook and Longhorn. There was another storage project called OpenEBS, but it's kind of faded out. So like I said, it's really up to you in terms of the things that you find interesting and rewarding and beneficial. Other opportunities, tons of them, all right? It's really, like I said, it's really based on your objectives. So the tags, right? CNCF, being an American entity, sometimes the acronyms and things, kind of like the military in terms of jargon and stuff you have to learn, but don't worry about that. Technical advisory group and working groups, right? So the technical advisory groups are based on different categories. There are a lot of them. If you just go to Google and type CNCF tag, you'll see all the different ones that are there. And so that might be a place where you might want to get involved. Let's say you don't want to just get involved in one particular project, but you're more interested in just like a topic, like observability, right? Or maybe you're interested in environmental sustainability. There are lots of different tags that you can get involved in, all right? Of course, there are other really fun, cool, I'm just listing off data projects because I know Jay on the Beach has a sort of data-based context, but Red Panda, also a sponsor, awesome company. And you've got a lot of other ones too, if you're into Postgres, things of that nature. In terms of my training partners, just want to give a massive shout out to these people who have been instrumental in my growth in different ways and at different times. From getting me onboarded in the CNCF in the very beginning, when I didn't know absolutely anything, to the people who I currently host the meetups with, Jorge and Courtney. Other things in terms of things you can do, like I said, podcasts that I run, Learn Kubernetes is the organization I work with, DevOps Toolkit with Victor Farsich, fantastic resource. The Kubernetes podcast from Google, certifications, it's another way to sort of have a framework to get the knowledge based on your objectives. Reddit is obviously helpful too. Also want to give a special shout out to two people who work at DataStax, Jeff Carpenter and Patrick McFadden, who wrote an O'Reilly book called Managing Cloud Native Data on Kubernetes. I highly recommend it if you're in the data side. And that's pretty much it. I mean, we got through most of this. Go the distance with your objectives. Think about this as a long-term process, right? It's not something that needs to be done in 1 week. And if you're not sure about this and if you want to explore it further, just reach out and talk to me, right? Have a solid corner, meaning build a team of people, training partners and trainers that are gonna make it easier for you. Power thrills, but speed kills. What do I mean by that? It's an ecosystem that moves very quickly. Find what's the best way for you to keep up with what's going on. You don't need to know everything. You don't need to spend 24 hours a day on Twitter or Reddit, but find the things that you like the most and stick with them. Find your signature shot based on your skills. What is it that you have to offer, considering the things that you've done, the things that you're good at, and the things that you enjoy? And then lastly, inside and outside the ring. Remember, this is not just the only thing out there, right? It's a way to, in the same way that I've taken this example of boxing and applied it, I'm sure all of you have different ways that can help you have the mentality that will make this experience more successful and more rewarding. Looks like we're out of time. Thank you very much.